Welcome to Beyond the Dark, where we plunge headfirst into the realms of the unexplained, the mysterious, and the extraordinary. I'm your host, Jay Rockwell, and together, we'll navigate the shadowy corridors of ufology, explore the world of cryptids, and venture into the cosmic unknown. From extraterrestrial encounters to the secrets of the paranormal, we leave no stone unturned. Join me as we embark on a journey that transcends the boundaries of reality. Heyo! What's going on, BTD fam? It's your boy Jay Rockwell, and we're here with another episode of Beyond the Dark, where tonight we're going to discuss cryptozoology, searching for hidden creatures. That's right. It's going to be like a more of a general overview. We're going to cover about five of the most popular cryptids, and it's hard to cover them all, so we're just going to touch on five. Okay? It should be a good one. Looking forward to tonight's topic. I hope everyone had a great weekend. I know I did. I went and got my mop adjusted, meaning my hair. Got a haircut. Yes, it was getting a little out of control. Hair everywhere. We watched a couple of horror movies. Horror is my favorite genre. I love scary movies. Year round, every day, all day. I'm the guy that's played Friday the 13th probably 8 million times on my Plex server. So, we watched Antlers with Kerry Russell. I believe it came out in 2021. And then last night we watched The Boogeyman, which is a 2023 release. Nobody that I knew of acting-wise, but Stephen King wrote it, and I liked both of the movies. Antlers towards the end, it was kind of like, okay, all right. But it was still cool. I liked it. And if you guys saw the movie, please let me know what you thought. The Boogeyman was just, it creeped me out. And my wife was like, it had me the whole time. My chest was so tight. I'm like, okay. Maybe we shouldn't be watching these when we're about to have a son in 25 days. That's right, in other news, 25 days until my son is born. December 13th is going to be the date that we go in for the C-section. And I'm just asking everybody, I'm not a religious kind of person. If you want to say a prayer, that's fine, but just send positive vibes and all that good stuff our way, well, to my wife, that everything goes according to plan, and that it happens on December 13th. Because we are set, we like the date, we have a name, I will reveal that when he is born. Excuse me. But, so actually I might as well touch on that. Obviously, with having a newborn, don't expect, the streams are going to become irregular. And when I say that, I mean maybe not every day. Probably not at 6:30 on the dot. It's going to kind of be a whenever it happens type thing. And, I mean, you got to understand that, you know? And I'm sure you do. So, I'm going to do my best to still deliver some AB sweetness to your life and to your ears. Some honey for the ears, right? I'm still into the show. Like, don't worry about that. Again, it may become a regular thing where, like, holy crap, okay, it's Monday night, I'm not ready. But The goal is once a week, still hit you with a Beyond the Dark episode covering a new topic. But yeah, last week's show was on time travel and temporal anomalies. Thanks for everyone who came out. I thought it was a really good show. Not as heavy as the multiverse theory, but it's still a little on the heavy side, but it was fun. I had a lot of fun, and there were stories in there that I was not privy to. Excuse all that background noise. Holy moly. Get it together, Jacob. Well, Jay. Oh, no. I've released my government name. Maybe I should edit that out. Nah, we're good. We're good. Hey, Beyond the Dark is available on Deezer, TuneIn, Radio Public, Pandora, Listen Notes, Spotify, and Google Podcasts. No, I still have not figured out the Apple Podcast edition. Recently been emailing very casually with another podcast host, and he has his on Apple. So I think I'm gonna hit him up. What do I need to do here? What am I missing? Remember, folks, we got the Discord and the Facebook community page. I believe the Facebook's at 84 follows, and the Discord again. Almost every day we're getting one new member, so that is really cool. That actually pumps me up, gets the blood flowing in my veins, because I'm a Discord boy. Okay, I love Discord, so it's refreshing to see you guys come in there. And I hope the video, I made a tutorial video this past week on how to use Discord specifically for Beyond the Dark server, just showing you the basics of how to post pictures, how to download files that I upload to the reading corner, and so on and so forth. Shout outs to all my coffee supporters. I start the morning off every day with the freshest cup of coffee. Thank you, Michelle, Afros Animation, and Sky Eyes. Folks, please send me all your stories, experiences, encounters, and questions to my email at beyondthedarkradio@outlook.com, or feel free to post in the Questions for Jay channel in the BTD Discord. Yeah, that's right. And what else did I have? We do have Phantom Frequencies Volume 2 coming your way. It looks like it's going to be a Thursday. It's going to be November 30th, a Thursday. So mark that on your calendars. That's going to be a 10 p.m. Exclusive release on YouTube. It also will hit all of the podcast hosts at 10 p.m. We have a holiday week this week, and that means a 3-day work week for Jay. Yes! I'm pumped. It's still stressful, though, because we have this holiday week, so it's only a 3-dayer, and December 8th is my last day of work until probably the first week of January, so I could be home with my son and help my wife. But in between that small time, I need to pack in a lot of work, and I need to tie up all the loose ends and make sure that my clients are happy. If any of you are curious, I am an account manager for a small MSP in Cleveland, Ohio. I did technical IT work for 10 years, and I wanted to get on the other side of the fence and see what the business side looked like. So I took that technical knowledge, and I can identify holes in companies' environments and tell them what they need to get them in a better place. So it's very interesting, and it's a lot of fun. It also brings a lot of stress sometimes, but I mean, hey, that goes with it, right? But all right, guys, November 20th, and we're going to get right into it. So let's go ahead and do the darn thing.
You are listening to Beyond the Dark with Jay Rockwell, and here's what's in the news.
Hey there, listeners. Today we've got some uplifting news from the world of climate science. Ever heard about the Greenland ice sheet? It's like Earth's gigantic freezer, right up there in the Arctic? Well, recent studies have brought us some hopeful insights. Turns out, even if we accidentally push past those daunting global warming levels, those ones that I talk about almost every week, There's a chance to flip the script and save Greenland's icy expanse. That's right. Reversing the melting is possible with swift and serious climate action. Now, picture Greenland. It's the second largest ice sheet on Earth. And if it were to melt completely, we're talking about a sea rise of over 23 feet. That's like stacking about four adults on top of each other. Coastal areas worldwide would face serious trouble. But here's the twist in the tale. Scientists, including a team from the Technical University of Munich, have been running simulations. And guess what? They found a glimmer of hope. Professor Nicholas Bowers, a big brain in Earth system modeling at TUM, and his team are telling us that we can still dodge this icy bullet. The key? Act fast and cool the Earth down if we overshoot those critical warming levels. But hey, this isn't a free pass to chill out on climate action. It's more of a wake-up call, a second chance to get it right. These researchers ran a ton of scenarios, like a climate marathon on supercomputers looking centuries ahead. And they're pretty confident that with the right moves, Greenland's ice sheet can bounce back. So what's the game plan? Well, it involves some heavy lifting like massive CO2 reduction and maybe even some high-tech carbon capture. The sooner we get the Earth's temperature back on track, the less extreme these measures need to be. There you have it, folks. A ray of hope from the nice icy north. It's like the Earth's giving us a rare second shot, and it's up to us to make it count. Tonight, we're talking about a stunning view you can catch in the evening sky. The one and only Saturn. If you've got a telescope or even a pair of binoculars, now's a prime time to gaze at this celestial beauty and its famous rings. But hold on. There's been a buzz online saying Saturn's rings might vanish by 2025. Sounds dramatic, right? Well, let's dive in and see what's really going on. First off, no need for alarm. Saturn's rings aren't disappearing forever. It's just a cosmic game of hide and seek. Here's the scoop. Earth and Saturn, like most things in space, are always moving. Our planet, tilted on its side, gives us our seasons. As we orbit the sun, we're tipping back and forth, showing off different hemispheres. Now, Saturn's doing its own tilting dance. It takes a lengthy 29.4 years to orbit the sun. And just like Earth, it's got a tilt. What does this mean for its rings? They're super thin and follow Saturn's tilt. So, at times, when we look at Saturn, we see the rings edge on, making them almost invisible from our viewpoint. Imagine holding a thin sheet of paper. It's easy to see when facing you, but turn it sideways, and poof, it nearly disappears. That's what's happening with Saturn's rings. In 2025, we're catching Saturn at a special angle where the rings look edge on and become hard to spot. This isn't new, though. It last happened in 2009, and sure enough, the rings came back into view after a few months. So, if you want a clear view of Saturn's iconic rings, now's a fantastic time. Grab your stargazing gear and enjoy the show. And don't worry, the rings will be back in full glory soon after their brief vanishing act. We've got a real jaw-dropper from the sands of Egypt. Picture this, an ancient underground tomb, secrets buried for centuries, and a team of eagle-eyed archaeologists stumbling upon something unexpected. In a recent excavation while sifting through the remnants of an old tomb near the Nile River, the team found something extraordinary. No, not a mummy or hidden treasure, but a lonely tooth nestled right inside a pelvis bone. Now, Melinda King Wetzel, the site supervisor, initially thought this was a tiny fetus from way back in the Pharaoh's days. But hold on, it gets weirder. After a closer look by the site's bioarchaeological director, Gretchen Dabbs, they realized they had stumbled upon something much rarer. A tumor, but not just any tumor. This was a mature ovarian teratoma, a kind of germ cell tumor. It's packed with fully formed tissues like bone and teeth. This tiny, calcified clump, just about 3 by 2 centimeters, dates back to the mid-14th century BC. Researchers are buzzing about it, saying it's shedding new light on how these conditions existed in the past. This find was part of the Amarna Project, a long-term excavation on the eastern banks of the Nile, uncovering the lives of regular folks from the Pharaoh Akhenaten's era, and the skeleton this tumor belonged to? A young woman, probably between 18 to 21, buried with her hands over her pelvis and decked in more jewelry than her peers. Here's where it gets even more intriguing. Teratomas like these are super rare in archaeology. In fact, this is just the fifth case ever found by archaeologists and the only one from Egypt. And it's centuries older than any others found in Spain, France, Peru, and Portugal. The team initially spotted one tooth, but further digs around the skeleton unearthed another tooth near the leg bone. These teeth, with their full enamel crowns, were too developed to be from a fetus. They were part of a tumor, separated over time. And a little tidbit to add some mystique, the woman had on a gold ring, right on her left hand, bearing an image of Bathe, the Egyptian deity linked to fertility and protection. The archaeologists think this might not be a coincidence. Maybe it was meant to address pain or infertility issues she was experiencing. This remarkable discovery was detailed in the International Journal of Paleopathology. Just goes to show, the past always has new secrets to unveil. Here's some exciting space news that's out of this world. China is making bold moves in the space race, aiming to outpace NASA with an ambitious Mars mission. They're not just planning to visit the red planet, they're looking to bring back a piece of it. By the year 2031, China expects to have Martian soil and rock samples right here on Earth. That's a good 2 years ahead of NASA's plan. This stellar mission is part of China's Tianwen program. They're gearing up for a double launch in 2028, which means we could see these Martian souvenirs by 2031. Now, get this. Chinese scientists have been working hard on a new Mars weather model. It's called Go Planet Mars, and it's all about simulating the Martian atmosphere. This is crucial for the Tianwen-3 mission's success. We're talking about predicting dust storms, which, let me tell you, have been a real headache for previous missions. Remember Opportunity and Insight? Those guys got knocked out by Martian dust. China's Go Mars model isn't just about making sure their mission goes smoothly. It's a big leap in understanding Mars' unique weather patterns. From dust cycles to surface temperatures, this model is like a Martian weather forecast. It's a game changer for planning future missions, especially when it comes to picking safe landing spots. And it's not just China in the space race. NASA and the European Space Agency are also planning to bring back Martian samples. Their mission is set to take off around 2033. So, the race to Mars is heating up, and it's not just about getting there. It's about understanding the planet and bringing a piece of it back home. Let's dive into a fascinating piece about our animal friends in zoos during the pandemic. You know, when the world went into lockdown, we weren't the only ones feeling the change. Zoo animals, especially our primate pals like bonobos, chimpanzees, gorillas, and baboons, experienced a whole new world without daily crowds. Researchers, in a study that hit the shelves last year, took a closer look at these changes. They found that these intelligent creatures adjusted their daily routines, showing variations in how much they rested and ate. It turns out that our visits to the zoo aren't just fun for us. They're a part of the animals' lives, too. But here's where it gets interesting. As we started to visit again, the animals shifted their behavior. The bonobos and gorillas, for example, enjoyed less alone time, and the gorillas even cut back on their naps. Our chimp friends started munching more and interacting with their surroundings in new ways. Over at the safari park, the olive baboons had their own reactions. They toned down their dominance displays and got more curious about visitor cars than the usual ranger vehicles. It's a bit of a puzzle, though, whether these changes were thumbs up or down for the animals. For some, like the chimpanzees and baboons, visitors seem to be a welcome stimulus. But for the more laid-back gorillas, the hustle and bustle might have been a bit much, seeing as they took fewer rest breaks. What's clear is that these animals are incredibly adaptable. They shifted where they hung out in their enclosures when we came back, showing they can handle some human hustle. Ellen Williams, a zoo animal welfare researcher, emphasizes how important it is for zoo habitats to support this kind of adaptability for the animals' well-being. One more intriguing find, there's a limit to how much stimulation is good for the animals. For the olive baboons, past a certain number of visitor cars, they didn't get any more active. This research is a goldmine for those looking to make zoos and safari parks better for our animal friends. It's a delicate balance between giving them a sense of companionship and avoiding making them feel annoyed or threatened. Even though lockdowns might be a thing of the past, fingers crossed, this study opens doors to more research. The team is planning to expand their work to include more animals and a longer timeline. Hey there, dog lovers! Today we've got some tail wagging news from the world of canine health. It's all about our furry friend's teeth, and how we might just have a new way to keep those gums healthy. So, let's dive into this fascinating find from a group of researchers in Japan. First off, did you know a whopping 44 to 100% of our canine pals suffer from gum disease? Yeah, it's a big deal, especially for the little guys and older pups. We've always been told to brush their teeth daily to fight off plaque and gum disease, but let's face it, not all of our four-legged friends are fans of the toothbrush. Enter the game changer. Aged garlic extract. That's right, garlic. But not the kind we cook with, which can be harmful to dogs. This is a special, odorless and less irritative form that's been aged like a fine wine. Researchers found that giving this to beagles with mild gingivitis actually improved their gum health without any side effects. How cool is that? Here's a quick science bite. Gingivitis in dogs, just like in humans, can lead to some serious trouble if not treated. We're talking about problems beyond bad breath, like heart and kidney diseases, and even cognitive issues. Now, we've known for ages that garlic is a bit of a wonder ingredient for us humans, tackling everything from asthma to heart issues. And it turns out, this aged garlic extract has some anti-inflammatory and anti-cancer properties too. So the researchers in Japan took a closer look at this. They prepared this special garlic extract, then tested it on 10 beagles with mild gingivitis. After mixing a bit of this garlic magic in their food for 8 weeks, they saw some promising results. The dog's gum health improved significantly compared to the ones who didn't get the garlic treatment. But hold on to your horses here, or should I say leashes. This study was pretty small and only focused on beagles with mild issues. The researchers are saying we need more studies on different breeds and more severe cases before we start adding garlic supplements to our dog's diet. So what's the takeaway for us dog parents? Well, keep brushing those canine teeth for now, but stay tuned. Aged garlic extract could soon be another tool in our pet care kit. It's always exciting to see science working to keep our furry family members healthy and happy. We've got some heartwarming news for all the parents out there, straight from the halls of Radboud University. Behavioral psychologist Kelly Kujmans has just revealed some fascinating findings in her latest research. And guess what? It's all about the magic of a simple, loving touch. Turns out, just an hour of skin-to-skin contact each day can make a world of difference for newborns and their moms. This isn't just your average cuddle session. We're talking about a special bonding time where the baby, wearing just a nappy, rests on their parent's bare chest. This cozy practice, especially in the first 5 weeks after birth, is showing some amazing benefits. For the little ones, it's like a soothing lullaby. Babies in the study who enjoyed this daily closeness cried less and seemed to snooze a bit more. And for the moms, less anxiety, less fatigue, and a bonus, they often continued breastfeeding for a longer stretch. It's a win-win. Kelly's research didn't just stop at the early days. She's keeping an eye on these kiddos, now 6 and 7 years old, to see if the benefits of those early cuddles have lasting effects. What's more, Kelly's hoping to spread this message far and wide. She's encouraging doctors and caregivers to recommend this simple, yet powerful practice to new parents. After all, sometimes the smallest gestures can make the biggest impact. So, for all you new parents out there, maybe it's time to try some extra cuddle time with your little one. It's not just about the warmth of the moment. It could be setting the stage for a happier, healthier start to life. And yes, I did pick this article out. Due to having my son soon. And it's something that they actually covered in our baby basics class that we took at the hospital. And they mentioned it again during breastfeeding class at the hospital. And they mentioned it again during my daddy boot camp class at the hospital. So it's very ingrained into their course, at least in Ohio, to promote the skin-on-skin contact, especially right after birth. That was the first thing we heard, is that, you know, they clean up the baby and then they put it directly on mom's chest. So keep your eye on that. The James Webb Space Telescope, a real game changer in space observation, has been busy peeking into the universe's secrets. It's brought us some fascinating news from a nearby exoplanet, WASP-107b. Imagine this. WASP-107b, a planet not too far from our own backyard, has an atmosphere filled with water vapor, sulfur dioxide. Wait for it. Sand clouds. Yeah, clouds made of silicate, which is essentially sand. It's like finding a piece of the Sahara floating around in space. This exoplanet is quite the oddball. It's almost as big as Jupiter, but has a mass closer to Neptune. This makes it super fluffy, kind of like a giant cosmic marshmallow, which allows astronomers to get a really good look at what's going on in its atmosphere. And what they've seen is pretty wild. The team, led by some sharp minds from the Institute of Astronomy, KU Leuven, used a cool tool called the Mid-Infrared Instrument, otherwise known as MIRI, on the Webb telescope. They found that the less dense atmosphere of WASP-107b is a treasure trove of information. Most notably, they were surprised to find sulfur dioxide there, something they didn't expect at all. It's like smelling the scent of burnt matches in a place where you wouldn't even find a matchbox. And then there are these high-altitude sand clouds, partially hiding the water vapor and sulfur dioxide. It's the first time astronomers have been able to pinpoint what these clouds are made of on an exoplanet. Think about it. Clouds of sand floating high up in the atmosphere of a distant world. It's something straight out of a sci-fi novel. But here's the kicker. The way these clouds exist and endure is fascinating. The sand particles evaporate in the deeper, hotter layers of the atmosphere, rise up, and then condense again into clouds. It's a bit like Earth's water cycle, but with sand. Isn't nature amazing? This discovery isn't just cool trivia, it's reshaping our understanding of how planets form and evolve, giving us new perspectives on our own solar system. The James Webb Space Telescope is truly revolutionizing how we look at exoplanets. And a shout out to the team behind the MIRI instrument, including those at KU Leuven and other institutions across Belgium, Europe, and the United States. Their 2 decades of hard work have really paid off, giving us this incredible insight into a world far, far away. So, next time you're out at night, looking up at the stars, just think about the wonders hidden in that vast expanse. From water vapor to sulfur dioxide, and even sand clouds, the universe is full of surprises, and we're just beginning to uncover them. Ever heard of earthquakes from the past causing tremors today? Well, that's exactly what some scientists are exploring. So picture this. Way back in the 1800s, some of the most intense earthquakes ever recorded hit the heart of North America. Fast forward to now, regions in the central and eastern U.S. might still feel the ripples from those century-old quakes. Now, when a big quake hits, it usually is followed by smaller quakes called aftershocks. These can last for days, months, or even years. But here's the twist. These aftershocks might be hanging around for much longer than we thought, possibly even hundreds of years. A team of sharp minds led by Eugene Shane, a geoscientist from Wuhan University dived into this. They published their findings in the Journal of Geophysical Research, Solid Earth. What they found is pretty intriguing. They looked at historic quakes, like a trio of big ones near the Missouri-Kentucky border back in 1811 and 1812, and another in Charleston, South Carolina in 1886. These areas don't usually get a lot of quakes. So the team wondered, are the tremors they're experiencing now just aftershocks from these old-timey quakes? To figure this out, they used some neat statistical methods on earthquake data from the U.S. Geological Survey. Their findings? Well, it's a mixed bag. Near Quebec, Canada, the tremors today seem unrelated to the quake from way back in 1663. But over by the Missouri-Kentucky border and down in Charleston, some of today's quakes might indeed be aftershocks from those historic events. This isn't just a trip down memory lane for earthquakes, though. Understanding these links helps scientists figure out future earthquake risks. Turns out, keeping an eye on the past might give us a heads up for what could shake down in the future. Lastly, we've got a fascinating piece of news straight from the pages of history. My favorite subject. Picture this. In Turkey, not Turkey, Turkey, I hope I'm pronouncing that right, among the dust of ages, archaeologists have stumbled upon something incredible. A secret text, hidden within thousands of ancient clay tablets from the time of the Hittite Empire. That's over 3,000 years old. Now, these tablets are not your usual find. They hold a mysterious language, something completely different from anything else found in the Middle East. It's like uncovering a whole new piece of our past, hidden in plain sight. And the story behind these writings? Straight out of an adventure novel. It turns out, this language was scribbled at the end of a text about a cultic ritual, in a language we know, the Hittite language, the oldest known Indo-European tongue. And here's where it gets intriguing. The text says, from now on, read in the language of the country of Chalasma. Who were the Chalasmans, you ask? They were part of an organized society from the Bronze Age, living on the fringes of the mighty Hittite Empire. Andreas Schachner, who's leading the excavation at the Hattusa ruins, felt the gravity of this discovery the moment he held the tablet. Compared to the 25,000 others found at the site, this one was in remarkable shape. For over a century, experts have been piecing together Hattusa's vast archive of texts, royal treatises, political letters, and religious writings. Here's a cool fact. The Hittites were known for recording rituals in foreign languages. Why? It wasn't just for knowledge. They were on a mission to expand their empire, respecting and adopting the gods and religions of the lands they conquered. The strategy was all about gaining respect and loyalty from their new subjects. Historian Tulin Senges sheds light on how the Hittites embraced deities from far-off lands like Syria and Mesopotamia. It shows a culture of tolerance and respect. A lesson from history, right? In the Hittite kingdom, worshipping their divine rulers was everything. The royal archives weren't just records. They were a testament to the empire's religious dedication and a tool for expansion. And here's a historical twist. The Chalasmans once fought alongside the Hittites against the Egyptians. Talk about alliances! Now, the big suspense. What does this newfound tablet actually say? Well, that's still a mystery. Photos and translations are under wraps as experts are deciphering this ancient puzzle. But hang tight, because sometime next year, we might just get to hear the secrets of the Chalasmans. And there was a story, I believe, about a month ago, where they're now using AI to decode ancient tablets. So I wonder if they're going to, they should look into that for this one, right? So as we wait to unravel this historical enigma, stay tuned and keep exploring the mysteries of our past. Who knows what other secrets lie buried, waiting to be discovered. Until next time, keep your curiosity alive. That concludes the news for November 20th, 2023. We're going to go ahead and take our first music break. Before that, I'm going to drop my first ad. I have asked week and week for people to send me your Etsy page, your eBay store, your website, anything you want me to promote. I've heard nothing. That's fine. I will plug my own stuff. Are you a card collector? A sports card trading card collector? Well, if so, I got some stuff for you. I run an eBay store called Tavern Collectibles on eBay. Obviously, I said eBay store. Where I sell singles. They are mostly all football. I love the sport of football. Hope you do too. Eventually, we will branch out into basketball and baseball. I don't follow those sports nearly as much as football. So I know what I'm getting into when I snag me some football goodies. But I sell most singles for 99 cents plus shipping. Shipping is usually 60 cents. So you're looking at about $1.60 for a card. Come and check me out. I usually have an inventory of about 200 cards up at any given time, and I ship next business day, and I am looking to, Christmas time's around the corner. Maybe you got a nephew, or maybe you got a son or a brother, or, you know, maybe you got a sister who's into that stuff, and they collect cards. Come and hit my store up, Tavern Collectibles on eBay. You can find the link below in the description. Shoutouts to MixKit.co, who provide all the sounds and music that you hear right here on Beyond the Dark. Go ahead and visit MixKit.co for some royalty-free music that you can use on your show. If you are looking to get your music out there, please hit me up on BeyondTheDarkRadio@Outlook.com. I will more than gladly promote your music and webpage. But yeah, I'll catch you guys in just a moment. We're going to dive right into cryptozoology. Darklings, and welcome back to Beyond the Dark. I am your host, Jay Rockwell, and tonight we're embarking on a fascinating journey into a realm that's often shrouded in mystery and intrigue, the world of cryptozoology. So, get comfortable, maybe pour yourself a cup of something warm, as we dive into the depths of the unknown, exploring the elusive and often disputed realm where the line between myth and reality blurs. Cryptozoology, for the uninitiated, is a field teetering on the fringes of mainstream science. It's the study of creatures that are believed to exist based on anecdotal evidence, folklore, and eyewitness accounts, but are yet to be proven by hard scientific evidence. These creatures, known as cryptids, range from sea serpents to sky-soaring beasts, lurking in the hidden corners of our world. But why does cryptozoology captivate so many? Is it merely a pursuit of fanciful tales, a modern extension of our ancestral storytelling? Or is there something more? A deeper, almost primal curiosity that drives us to explore the unknown? Cryptozoology challenges our understanding of the world, urging us to question the boundaries between the known and the undiscovered. Now, let's take a moment to ponder the significance of cryptozoology in our understanding of nature. It's a field that exists in the tantalizing space between established zoological science and the expansive realm of folklore. In many ways, it's a celebration of human curiosity and the enduring allure of the unexplained. For every cryptid story, there's a blend of history, culture, and a deep-seated human need to make sense of the inexplicable elements of our world. Delving deeper, cryptozoology often reflects the cultural and geographical diversity of our planet. Each region has its unique cryptids, born out of local folklore and ecological contexts. For instance, the dense forests of North America are the reputed home of Bigfoot, while the high-altitude Himalayas claim the Yeti. These creatures, though lacking in hard scientific proof, are vividly alive in the imaginations and narratives of the people who share their stories. Furthermore, cryptozoology occasionally intersects with conventional science. History is dotted with instances where mythic creatures turned out to be real, previously unknown species. The giant squid, once a mariner's nightmare spun in tales, is now a recognized marine creature. The okapi, a forest-dwelling animal in Central Africa, was once thought to be a myth until science confirmed its existence. These examples demonstrate that the realms of myth and reality are not always distinct, and that cryptozoology can sometimes pave the way for genuine scientific discoveries. But it's not just about finding new species. Cryptozoology also challenges our understanding of extinction. Some cryptids, like the Tasmanian tiger, are believed to be surviving members of species thought extinct. Their alleged sightings ignite discussions about conservation, habitat loss, and our understanding of ecological histories. As we delve into the tales and purported sightings of cryptids, it's important to approach them with a balanced perspective. Skepticism and belief coexist in the world of cryptozoology, often leading to heated debates and extensive research. For every claim of a sighting, there's a demand for proof, a photograph, a footprint, something tangible. Yet, the lack of concrete evidence doesn't deter the search. Instead, it fuels the intrigue, inspiring explorers, scientists, and enthusiasts to keep looking, to keep questioning. In summary, cryptozoology represents a unique intersection of science, folklore, and the human imagination. It's a field that not only seeks to uncover hidden creatures, but also to understand the cultural narratives that give birth to these legends. It reminds us that the world is still full of mysteries, waiting to be explored and understood. And that sometimes, the journey in search of answers is as fascinating as the answers themselves. As we continue tonight's show, remember, cryptozoology isn't just about chasing shadows, it's about the pursuit of wonder, the exploration of the uncharted, and the celebration of the world's untold stories. As we delve into the realm of specific cryptids, let's begin with perhaps the most iconic and widely recognized of them all. Bigfoot, also known as Sasquatch. This legendary creature, reputed to inhabit the vast, uncharted forests of North America, has captured the imagination of believers, skeptics, and scientists alike. So tonight, let's step softly into the world of this elusive giant and explore the mystery that has perplexed many for decades. Bigfoot is typically described as a large, bipedal humanoid covered in thick, dark hair. Witnesses often report a creature standing between 6 to 10 feet tall, with a robust, muscular build, and an unmistakable, pungent odor. The most compelling physical evidence for Bigfoot's existence? the massive footprints left behind, some measuring as long as 24 inches and 8 inches wide, given the creature its name. But what exactly is Bigfoot? Theories range widely. Some believe Bigfoot to be a remnant population of Gigantopithecus. Woo! Probably mispronounced that. A giant prehistoric ape that once roamed Asia and could have crossed into North America via the Barren Land Bridge. Others propose that Bigfoot is an undiscovered species of great ape, or even a human-ape hybrid. And then, there are those who see Bigfoot as a supernatural being, transcending the physical laws of nature. The cultural impact of Bigfoot is undeniable. Native American tribes across the Pacific Northwest have long told stories of Sasquatch-like creatures, often depicted in their art and oral histories. These tales vary from tribe to tribe. Some view Bigfoot as a benign, almost guardian-like figure of the wilderness, while others regard it with a mix of awe and apprehension, as a symbol of the untamed and unknown aspects of the natural world. In the realm of modern encounters, the first widely recognized sighting of Bigfoot was reported in 1958, when enormous footprints were discovered in Bluff Creek, California. This incident catapulted Bigfoot into the public consciousness, sparking a wave of interest in subsequent sightings. But it was the 1967 Patterson-Gimlin film that truly turned Bigfoot into a household name. This short film clip, showing a large, hairy, bipedal figure walking through a clearing, remains one of the most hotly debated pieces of visual evidence in cryptozoology. Despite numerous expeditions, advanced technological methods employed in wildlife tracking, and the ever-growing body of alleged sightings, physical evidence of Bigfoot remains elusive. Skeptics point to the lack of conclusive DNA evidence and the high probability of hoaxes. Yet, for many, the absence of irrefutable proof is not a deterrent but rather a catalyst for continued exploration and fascination. The search for Bigfoot is more than a quest for a cryptid. It's a journey into the unknown, an exploration of the wild and untamed parts of our world, and perhaps of ourselves. It challenges our perceptions of what is possible, asking us to consider the existence of something extraordinary just beyond our understanding. The mystery of Bigfoot represents a profound intersection of nature, culture, and the human psyche, a reminder of the deep-rooted connections we share with our environment and the mysteries it holds. As we ponder the existence of this gentle giant of the forest, let's remember that Bigfoot, real or not, has become an integral part of our cultural narrative. It invites us to keep our minds open to the wonders and possibilities that lie hidden in the dense forests of our vast and beautiful planet. From the dense forests of North America, our journey takes us across the Atlantic to the misty waters of Scotland, where a legend is deep and enigmatic as the loch itself resides. Yes, I'm talking about the Loch Ness Monster, affectionately known as Nessie. This cryptid, perhaps the most famous aquatic mystery in the world, has been a subject of fascination, debate, and scientific inquiry for decades. So let's dive into the dark, peat-rich waters of Loch Ness and uncover the story of this elusive creature. The legend of Nessie is deeply ingrained in Scottish folklore, with the earliest reports dating back to the 6th century. However, it was in 1933 that the modern legend truly took shape, following a surge in sightings and the publication of a now-famous photograph known as the Surgeon's Photo, which purported to show the monster's long, serpentine neck. Though later revealed to be a hoax, this image cemented the Loch Ness Monster in the public imagination. Nessie is often described as having a long, slender neck, a horse-like head, a humped back, and a powerful tail, characteristics typically associated with aquatic dinosaurs like the plesiosaur. This has led to theories that Nessie could be a remnant of the prehistoric era, somehow surviving in the depths of Loch Ness. Others hypothesize that Nessie could be a giant eel, or a species of a large, unknown aquatic animal adapted to the cold, deep waters of the loch. Over the years, numerous expeditions have been launched to find Nessie, employing everything from sonar to underwater cameras. In recent years, DNA sampling techniques have been used to catalog the biodiversity of Loch Ness, offering a scientific approach to uncovering the mystery. While these efforts have provided valuable data about the loch's ecosystem, they have yet to offer conclusive proof of Nessie's existence. Despite the lack of scientific evidence, the cultural impact of the Loch Ness Monster is undeniable. Nessie has become a symbol of the unknown, a creature that captures our imagination and challenges our understanding of the natural world. It's a story that has inspired countless books, films, and even scientific studies. The Loch Ness Monster also holds a significant place in Scottish tourism, drawing visitors from around the globe, all hoping for a glimpse of the elusive beast. The enduring appeal of Nessie can be attributed to our innate love for mysteries and the allure of exploring the unexplained. Each reported sighting and photograph sparks a new wave of intrigue and speculation. For many, Nessie is more than just a possible cryptid. It's a testament to the power of legend and the human capacity for wonder. As we reflect on the story of the Loch Ness Monster, it's essential to appreciate the blend of myth and reality that such tales embody. In a world where so much is known and mapped, legends like Nessie remind us of the mysteries that still linger in the hidden corners of our planet. They encourage us to look beyond the surface, to question, and to imagine. Whether Nessie exists or not, the legend lives on, a captivating enigma in the heart of Scotland's Highlands. Leaving behind the chilly waters of Loch Ness, we now venture into the warmer climates of Latin America, where a more recent yet equally chilling cryptid lurks in the shadows. Tonight, we explore the enigmatic Chupacabra, a creature whose name alone, meaning goat sucker in Spanish, evokes images of a fearsome predator of the night. This creature, emerging into the public eye in the 1990s, has since become a phenomenon, sparking fear, curiosity, and intrigue across continents. The legend of the Chupacabra began in Puerto Rico in the 1990s, following reports of livestock, particularly goats, being found dead with peculiar, precise incisions and reportedly drained of blood. The descriptions of the Chupacabra vary significantly, but the most common portrayal is of a reptile-like creature, about 3 to 4 feet tall, with scaly greenish-gray skin, sharp spines or quills running down its back, and red, glowing eyes. Some reports describe it as having a dog-like or kangaroo-like appearance, adding to the mystery of its true nature. The Chupacabra quickly captured the public's imagination, not only in Puerto Rico, but across Latin America, and even in the southwestern United States. Each new sighting added to the creature's lore, with some describing it as a fearsome predator, while others painted it as a shy, elusive creature, avoiding human contact. What sets the Chupacabra apart from other cryptids is its relatively recent appearance in the annals of cryptozoology. Unlike Bigfoot or Nessie, whose stories are deeply rooted in history and folklore, the Chupacabra phenomenon exploded in the modern era, propelled by media coverage and the growing influence of the internet. This has led to a unique blend of traditional folklore and contemporary urban legend, making the Chupacabra a symbol of modern myth-making. Scientists and skeptics have offered various explanations for Chupacabra sightings and the associated livestock deaths. These range from misidentified wild dogs or coyotes with mange, which makes their fur patchy and gives their skin a reptilian appearance, to the possibility of known predators like birds of prey or feral dogs being responsible for the attacks. Others suggest mass hysteria or hoaxes as explanations for the widespread reports of the creature. Despite these rational explanations, the Chupacabra remains a potent figure in popular culture. It has inspired numerous works of fiction, documentaries, and even research by cryptozoologists and enthusiasts. The creature's impact is a testament to its ability to tap into our primal fears and fascinations with the unknown and the monstrous. As we ponder the mystery of the chupacabra, it's crucial to consider the broader implications of such cryptids in our culture. They reflect our innate desire to explain the unexplainable, to give form to our fears, and to grapple with the idea that there may be creatures out there that defy our understanding of the natural world. The chupacabra, real or not, embodies the enduring allure of the cryptid, a creature that lives at the edge of our imagination and reality, challenging our perceptions and inviting us to explore the mysteries that lie in the shadows. As we continue our nocturnal journey through the realm of cryptozoology, we turn our gaze to a small town in West Virginia, where a series of strange sightings gave birth to one of the most intriguing and unsettling cryptids of modern times, the Mothman. Remember, a few weeks ago we covered the Mothman. It's one of our most popular episodes. If you have not listened to that, I suggest for a more thorough, detailed story, go back and listen to that one. It's really good. This creature, with its imposing presence and mysterious origins, has become a fixture in the world of paranormal and cryptid lore. Tonight, let's unfold the wings of this enigmatic entity and explore the depths of the Mothman mystery. The story of the Mothman begins in the mid-1960s in Point Pleasant, West Virginia. It was here, in this seemingly unremarkable small town, that the Mothman first made its appearance, sparking a series of events that would leave an indelible mark on the community and cryptid enthusiasts worldwide. Described as a large, winged humanoid with piercing, glowing red eyes, the Mothman was reported by multiple witnesses who were both fascinated and terrified by their encounters with this inexplicable being. The Mothman was not just a fleeting apparition. Its presence was intertwined with a series of bizarre and, some say, ominous events in Point Pleasant. The most chilling of these was the collapse of the Silver Bridge in 1967. This tragic incident, which claimed 46 lives, occurred during the height of the Mothman sightings, leading to speculation that the creature was somehow a harbinger of doom, an omen of the impending disaster. This connection between the Mothman and the Silver Bridge collapse has been a subject of much debate and speculation. Some believe that the Mothman sightings were mere coincidence, while others argue that the creature was a supernatural entity, a warning of the tragedy to come. The Mothman's role as a potential harbinger adds a layer of complexity to its legend, elevating it from a mere cryptid sighting to a phenomenon interwoven with themes of prophecy and doom. In exploring the Mothman, it's crucial to consider the broader cultural and psychological context of its sightings. The 1960s were a time of great change and uncertainty, with the Cold War, political upheavals, and social transformations shaping public consciousness. The Mothman, in many ways, can be seen as a manifestation of the collective anxieties and fears of the era, a physical embodiment of the unknown and the unsettling changes taking place in society. The legacy of the Mothman extends far beyond the boundaries of Point Pleasant. It has inspired books, documentaries, a feature film, and even an annual festival in the town where it was first sighted. The Mothman has become a symbol of the mysterious and the unexplained, a creature that challenges our understanding of reality and the natural world. As we delve into the Mothman, we're reminded of the power of myth and legend in shaping our perception of the world. The Mothman, whether a misunderstood creature, a supernatural entity, or a product of mass hysteria, represents the enduring human fascination with the unknown. It's a tale that encourages us to question the boundaries of our knowledge and to confront the mysteries that still linger in the shadows of our understanding. Our journey through the intriguing world of cryptozoology brings us to our final cryptid of the evening, a creature steeped in American folklore and shrouded in the shadows of the Pine Barrens of New Jersey. This is the realm of the Jersey Devil, a legendary being whose story is a rich tapestry of folklore, fear, and fascination. Tonight, let's venture into the dense, whispering pines to uncover the story of this creature. The legend of the Jersey Devil dates back to the 1700s, making it one of the oldest cryptid tales in the United States. According to popular folklore, the creature was the 13th child of a woman named Mother Leeds. Cursed before its birth and born during a tumultuous stormy night, the child transformed into a demonic creature, sprouting wings, hooves, and a forked tail before disappearing into the dark, dense forests of the Pine Barrens. The physical description of the Jersey Devil varies, but most accounts agree on a certain eerie characteristics. It's often depicted as having a horse-like head, bat-like wings, cloven hooves, and a piercing, high-pitched scream that can chill the very soul. Over the centuries, this creature has been woven into the fabric of New Jersey's folklore, emerging from the shadowy Pine Barrens to stir the imaginations and fears of locals and outsiders alike. The Jersey Devil's legend is more than just a tale of a fearsome creature. It's a story that has evolved over time, incorporating elements of local history, folklore, and cultural identity. The Pine Barrens, with their vast and often impenetrable forests, provide the perfect backdrop for this cryptid legend. The area's history of isolation, economic struggles, and the mysterious, often foreboding nature of the landscape have all contributed to the endurance and evolution of the Jersey Devil myth. Over the years, there have been numerous reported sightings of the Jersey Devil, each adding to the lore. The most famous of these occurred in 1909, when a wave of sightings over a week-long period caused widespread panic and drew national attention. Schools closed, mills shut down, and vigilante groups roamed the Pine Barrens in search of the creature. This was for real. Despite these efforts, the Jersey Devil eluded capture, and its legend only growing in the wake of this hysteria. Skeptics and scientists offer various explanations for the sightings and the legend itself. Some suggest that the stories of the Jersey Devil could be the result of a misidentified wildlife, such as owls, deer, or even stray dogs. Others see the legend as a product of social and economic tensions, a symbol of the fears and uncertainties facing the people of the Pine Barrens throughout history. Yet, for believers and enthusiasts, the Jersey Devil remains a captivating enigma, a creature that symbolizes the wild and unknown aspects of our world. It's a reminder that there are still mysteries lurking in the forgotten corners of our landscape, tales that blur the lines between reality and myth. As we conclude our exploration of the Jersey Devil, let's appreciate the power of folklore and legend in shaping our understanding of the world. Whether a real creature or a mythical being, the Jersey Devil embodies the human fascination with the unknown and the unexplained, a testament to the enduring allure of the mysteries that lie hidden in the dark, whispering forests of our collective imagination. As we wrap up tonight's journey into the world of cryptozoology, it's important to remember that the study of cryptids is more than just a pursuit of mythical beasts. It's a testament to human curiosity and the unending quest to understand the unknown. Whether these creatures are real or simply figments of our collective imagination, they serve as powerful symbols of the mysteries that still exist in our world. Thank you for joining me tonight on Beyond the Dark. Stay curious, keep your eyes open, and who knows? Maybe one day you'll have your own cryptid story to tell. And that concludes our cryptozoology special for tonight. I plan on doing several more of these because there are so many cryptids, and I'm going to do 5 to 7 of them at a time. And we're also going to do like full shows dedicated to some of the more popular ones. So all you Bigfoot lovers out there, don't worry. We got a bigger story coming, okay? I got a friend out there that is big into Bigfoot, and I don't know if it's the proper title. She'll probably chew me out if it's not, but something like a junior researcher. She's on a team, an official team now, that look into Bigfoot sightings, and I believe she's in the Carolinas. So, yeah, it's pretty wild. And she actually posted a photo of I think it's a casing or footprint casting, or whatever you want to call it, in the encrypted channel. So go and check that out. A little update as we head towards the trivia question. You remember 2 weeks ago we had the Bermuda Triangle and no one answered. Well, Matt Hatter did answer, and he got it correct. He just sent it to me like the night of the day I recorded the show. So I wasn't going to re-record it just to, you know, add that in, but I did shout it out in chat, so I will shout him out now. Matt Hatter, great job on the Bermuda Triangle question. The answer was compass. You got it correct. Thank you so much for your participation. You get 10 points. Also, last week with time travel and temporal anomalies, he also got that right, and he sent it in almost right away. So Matt Hatter, you are on a 2-week win streak, my friend, and you have 20 points. I'm thinking that we break this up into seasons for points, like maybe 3 months, so that's 12 shows. And then whoever has the most points at the end of the season, maybe they get to dictate what subject I cover next. I'm going to come up with something, don't worry. I'm keeping track. Matt Hatter has 20 points, and Donald Adams has 10 points. So I'm going to give you guys tonight's trivia question. I strongly encourage you to participate. Please, if you're watching the premiere right now, tonight, do not answer me in chat, okay? Send it, and don't send it to me on Discord or Facebook. Email me, beyondthedarkradio@outlook.com. The first person to answer me correctly will get a shout-out on next week's show and 10 points. So without further ado, here is tonight's trivia question. According to folklore, how many children did Mother Leeds have before the birth of the creature known as the Jersey Devil? I will repeat the question. According to folklore, how many children did Mother Leeds have before the birth of the creature known as the Jersey Devil? Folks, the answer is right inside the main segment. If you weren't paying attention, just go back about 10 minutes and give it a listen, and then shoot me an email, okay? First correct answer that is email to beyondthedarkradio@outlook.com. We'll get a shout-out on next week's show and 10 points. All right, guys, we're going to go ahead and take another music break. Shout-outs to Mixkit.co for providing all the music and sounds that you hear right here on Beyond the Dark. If you're looking to get your music featured, please hit me up at beyondthedarkradio@outlook.com. That is beyondthedarkradio@outlook.com. We got the book club and short story segment coming up next. I'll catch you guys in a second.
Welcome back to Beyond the Dark with Jay Rockwell.
Here I am. We are back, and we're going to kick off our BTD book club. Last week, we didn't have anything for you, and I apologize about that. A few people actually reached out to me and told me that they enjoy this, and that's awesome. Let's get our book club going, guys. This week's book is Hale Lindsey's Blood Moon. It is a work of nonfiction, just to let you know. And actually, I screwed that up. Do I know the difference between fiction and nonfiction? Apparently not. It is a work of fiction. Loosely based on nonfiction. Holy moly. I need more coffee. Where are my coffee supporters? All right. So, Blood Moon by Hale Lindsey is quite the page-turner, especially if you're into books that delve into end-time prophecies. Now, I'm not particularly religious, but I gotta say, this book had some intriguing bits that made me ponder the whole what's gonna happen in the end scenario. Lindsey has a way of blending biblical prophecies with current events, which honestly is kind of fascinating, even for a skeptic. However, I gotta admit, towards the end, the book did feel a bit like it was running in circles, a bit dull and repetitive, you know? But hey, overall, it's a fast and easy read. It's not heavy or super deep, which is great if you're just looking to dip your toes into this kind of topic without getting bogged down in theological debates. So yeah, it's a decent read that makes you question things, even if you're not coming at it from a religious angle. That's my short overview of Hale Lindsey's Blood Moon. I finished that book last week. I am currently reading, in case you want to know, My Descent into Death, A Second Chance at Life by Howard Storm. And if you recall, that was our first BTD book club review, and that one was done by Rev Kim Love. So I'm like, I got to read that, because I love that episode of Art Bell. I believe it's called Sarah's Hell. And Howard Storm is the guest. It's named Sarah's Hell because Sarah tells her story, but Howard tells his before. You know, Sarah's kind of like a call-in, I think, whereas Howard Storm's like a legit, you know, reputed guest. And he tells his story, and he was an atheist that, like, didn't even believe in any of this stuff, man. And then he had an NDE in France. And, whew, I mean, it is a very tiny book. We're talking 140 pages. But, like, man, the context. I mean, I'm only 20-something pages in, and just the context. The visuals that you get in your head while you're reading this is... it's pretty chilling. So I recommend that you guys read that book if you haven't. We're going to jump right into our short story segment. Remember, if you want to read along and see the pictures that go along with this short story, Moonlit Shadows, by all means, click the links down low in the description. And we're going to read chapters 3 and 4 of Moonlit Shadows. You ready? Moonlit Shadows, Chapter 3, Whispers in the Dark. The night weighed heavy on the small town of Derryville, its streets shrouded in a cloak of unease. Whispers of the encounter between Timmy, Charlie, and the creature had spread through the community like wildfire, fueling a sense of paranoia that tainted even the simplest of interactions. As Timmy and Charlie walked the familiar path to school, they couldn't help but notice the wary glances from their neighbors. The townspeople spoke in hushed tones, their voices laden with fear and suspicion. Timmy overheard snippets of conversation that sent shivers down his spine, alluding to dark secrets and hidden truths. His young mind was a sponge, absorbing every detail, every fragment of information that slipped through the cracks. And soon, Timmy realized there was more to Derryville than met the eye. The whispers in the dark spoke of a town with a haunting past, a place that had carried a weight of its own sins. Guided by insatiable curiosity, Timmy sought answers from anyone willing to share. He approached Mrs. Glick, the town's oldest resident, her wrinkled face a tapestry of memories. She spoke in hushed tones, her voice laced with a mix of regret and resignation. "There are things, child, things that lurk in the shadows," Mrs. Glick whispered, her voice barely audible. "Derryville has always been haunted, a playground for the darkness that resides in every town." She went on to recount tales of mysterious disappearances, long-forgotten tragedies, and a pact made in desperation. Timmy listened intently, his eyes widening with each revelation. The town he had believed to be a haven was a fragile facade, masking a history steeped in darkness. But as Timmy delved deeper into the town's secrets, he noticed a pattern emerging. The strange occurrences and unexplained phenomena seemed to align with the lunar cycle. Every month, as the full moon cast its eerie glow, the town was gripped by a palpable tension. Driven by an unrelenting urge to connect the dots, Timmy spent his nights scouring old newspapers, seeking clues that would unlock the town's secrets. As he pieced together the fragments of history, he discovered a thread that tied the present to a tragedy that had unfolded years ago. The more Timmy dug, the clearer the picture became. The town had made a deal, a pact with an ancient force that demanded a sacrifice every full moon. A pact that had been kept hidden for generations. The murders that had plagued Derryville were not the work of a madman, but rather the fulfillment of a sinister agreement. The weight of this revelation settled heavily on Timmy's shoulders. He knew he had stumbled upon something beyond his wildest nightmares, a truth that threatened to tear apart the delicate tapestry of his town. But he also realized that he couldn't carry this burden alone. He needed allies, individuals willing to face the horrors that lurked in the shadows alongside him. Armed with the knowledge he had gleaned, Timmy approached Charlie with the truth he had uncovered. His friend's initial skepticism melted away as he saw the conviction in Timmy's eyes. Together, they formed a pact of their own. A pact to confront the darkness that had taken a hold of their town. As whispers continued to echo through Derryville, Timmy and Charlie became beacons of defiance against the encroaching terror. The townspeople, still mired in fear, looked to them with a mix of hope and trepidation. And as the next full moon loomed on the horizon, the stage was set for a battle that would decide the fate of their once peaceful community. Chapter 4. The Secret Journal. Timmy's hands trembled as he opened the dusty attic door, its hinges creaking in protest. A shaft of pale light cut through the darkness, revealing a space cluttered with forgotten relics. His heart raced with anticipation, for he knew that hidden within these forgotten treasures lay a key to unlocking the mysteries that plagued Derryville. His gaze fell upon an old wooden chest tucked away in the corner, its weathered exterior bearing the marks of time. With careful hands, he pried open the lid, revealing a trove of yellowed papers and faded photographs. Among the artifacts of the past, his eyes were drawn to a leather-bound journal, the secret keeper of long-forgotten truths. As Timmy flipped through its pages, he felt a connection to the author, a man named Samuel Carver, who had lived in Derryville over a century ago. The journal chronicled his descent into darkness, his dealings with forces beyond mortal understanding. It spoke of a sinister pact, the same pact that now threatened the lives of the town's inhabitants. In hushed whispers, Samuel recounted the first encounter with the creature, the same creature that now haunted Timmy's dreams. It had arrived in Derryville like a harbinger of doom, marking the town as its hunting ground. Samuel's words painted a vivid picture of terror, a creature driven by insatiable hunger, a creature known as the werewolf. The journal revealed that Samuel had discovered the truth behind the creature's existence, a curse that had plagued his family for generations. The moon's embrace transformed them into bloodthirsty beasts, their humanity consumed by an ancient curse. With each full moon, they were compelled to kill, sacrificing innocent lives to satisfy their primal urges. As Timmy absorbed the revelations within the journal, his mind spun with possibilities. The answers to their struggle lay within these pages. A glimpse into the origins of the curse and the means to break its grip on Derryville. He knew that the key to stopping the werewolf and saving their town resided in understanding its history. Days turned into nights as Timmy delved deeper into our journal's secrets. He discovered passages that hinted at a ritual, a ritual that could potentially sever the bond between the werewolf and its host. The words danced before his eyes, and he began to piece together the steps required to perform the ancient ceremony. Armed with this newfound knowledge, Timmy sought out Charlie once again, sharing the journal's revelations. They pored over the passages, their minds ablaze with determination. Together, they formulated a plan to gather the necessary items and perform the ritual when the next full moon cast its ominous glow upon Derryville. The town, still gripped by fear, looked to Timmy and Charlie as beacons of hope. Their eyes held a glimmer of trust, their hopes tethered to the belief that these two young boys could save them from the clutches of the supernatural. As the days passed, Timmy and Charlie scoured the town for the required elements, their actions shrouded in secrecy. They knew that the werewolf's influence stretched far, and their every move could be watched. But their determination burned brighter than ever, fueled by the collective weight of Derryville's expectations. The night of the next full moon drew near, casting an uneasy tension over the town. The streets were empty, the air thick with anticipation. In a hidden cellar, Timmy and Charlie gathered the final ingredients, the tools that would help them perform the ancient ritual. Their hands shook, but their resolve remained unyielding. The time had come to face their darkest fears, to confront the creature that had ravaged their town for far too long. With the secret journal clutched tightly in Timmy's hand, they ventured out into the moonlit night, prepared to challenge the beast that lurked within the shadows. And that concludes chapters 3 and 4 of Moonlit Shadows. I hope you all enjoyed that story, and there is more to come next week. Remember, folks, please send in all your stories, experiences, encounters, and questions to beyondthedarkradio@outlook.com. I look very much to hearing from all of you. I reply to every single email. Also, remember, this month, November 30th, it's a Thursday, we got Phantom Frequencies Volume 2 coming at you, okay? It's going to be sweet. The stories have kind of dropped off from submissions, and that's okay, but we do have a nice little handful right now. And I am currently looking for some Thanksgiving-themed spooky stories. Oh, yeah. Gobble, gobble, gobble. Some ghost turkeys or something. I'll figure it out. I'll find something, guys. But also remember the Facebook community page and the Discord links below down in the description. Come and be a part of the community, okay? We're growing every day, and it's amazing to see all of you. Shout-outs to all the coffee supporters out there for supporting me with delicious coffee. Michelle, Afros Animation, and Sky Eyes. And a big shout-outs to Mixkit.co for providing all the music and sounds that you hear right here on Beyond the Dark. If you want your music featured, and you're like, Jay, you got to play something else, man. Like, I like the music, I dig it, but it's every week. We need something fresh. Send it to your boy. BeyondTheDarkRadio@Outlook.com. That is BeyondTheDarkRadio@Outlook.com. I hope all of you enjoyed tonight's program. If you did, please hit the like button. Please hit the subscribe button. And please turn all notifications on so that you can receive a ping when I make a post or I go live. We go live every night at 6:30 p.m. Eastern with some AB. And we have our 10 o'clock p.m. Eastern premiere every Monday for Beyond the Dark. This is Jay Rockwell, and this has been another great episode of Beyond the Dark, and I hope to see you all next Monday night. Take care. Peace.